Proverbs chapter 26. As snow in the summer, which is not really a thing that happens, it's freak by nature, and as rain in harvest, well, it's going to ruin the crops and the time that it takes to harvest. And it's amazing how the Bible speaks much on weather, where weather comes from, the source of the weather, and uses weather as a tool for illustration. So these weird summer events brings you to, so honor is not seemly for a fool, not fit. I get a blizzard in the snow, then give some fool honor. America honors fools. America is a freak of nature. America is against the Bible. Now, there are three kinds of fools. They're born, physical. They're educated, Romans 1:32. And they reject God, Psalms 14:1 and 53 verse 1. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. That's a fool. So don't honor them. How many Christ-rejecting fools are honored, God-rejecting fools that are honored in the public school system? That are against God. Their names are not written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And yet they promote their learning about their lives. Probably wickedness. Verse 2 is a little hard to understand. As the bird by wandering, as the swallow by flying, so the curse causeless shall not come. And break it down, really, it comes down to, if a man curses you, you don't need to worry about it. The only one you need to worry about when it comes to cursing is God. And we've had a curse of God given to Adam and Eve, Genesis chapter 3, that is still active. So, don't worry about people cursing you. A whip for the horse, a bridle for the ass, and a rod for the fool's back. Those are training needs. You use a whip to get the horse going and do what you need to be doing. The bridle for the ass is the position of the ass to where to go. And the rod for a fool's back. And up to chapter 26, we've read about and we've studied about correction of children. And that God in the Bible and the Holy Spirit way of correcting is the rod. So the Bible speaks that children are fools. As any man that falls into sin and does things that they're not supposed to, that they need correction. Christians can be fools because Hebrews says that God is our Father, corrects us. We ought not to be like fools. You know? Answer not a fool according to his folly. Answer not a fool according to his folly. Don't waste your time. Lest thou, you, also be like unto him. Don't answer a fool being foolish. Because people were walking by going to say, huh, there's two fools talking. You ruin your character. You ruin who you are. Now, where to give them the truth? That's what we're to give them. Answer a fool according to his folly, lest he be wise in his own conceit. He, the fool. We're to give them the right answer. And if you answer him by his foolishness, well, you're going to make him think he's smart. When he's a fool. You give yourself this foolishness and just say this prayer and you'll be saved. Oh, he's going to walk away. Hey, I'm wise. I'm saved. And he's not. And God will say something like to him, thou fool, thy soul shall... I said the prayer. Didn't I go to church? Didn't I sing your hymnals? Didn't I... But I never knew you. He that sendeth a message by the hand of a fool cutteth off the feet and drinketh damage. Ouch. Unable to go nowhere. If you cut off the feet, I don't think you're going to do too much walking. And drinketh damage? You know, you imagine you're sitting or going through a grocery store, and they got these all these free trial things you can snack on while through the store. Imagine, here's this one, boo, damage. Have a drink. And Elisha's tired. They're out. They're having soup or a bowl of pottage or something. And one guy screams out, hell, there's death in the pot. Somebody's put something in the pot that doesn't need to be there. And in time of battle, in a time that you didn't have telephones or anything like that, when you needed a message to be sent out, you don't send it in the hand of a fool. You know, if you'll get there, or get to the right person, the right time. There are some people in the postal service, you know, they'll take certain envelopes and they know that will have cash or something in them. They've been reported, some of them, you know, they just dump the mail because they don't want to carry it. Those are fools. When you send a message and something has to do, whatever like that, when you send it in the fool, it may not get there. The legs of the lame are not equal. I knew a guy like that from the war. You got to do something to correct the foot. Or you put something in a higher shoe or... But without corrective measures, he's got to tilt himself to stand. So the legs of a lame, I mean just lame, are not equal. Shows a parable in the mouth of fool. And there are schools and churches worldwide that fools are from the podiums, from the pulpits, whatever you want to call it. And it's not equal. They'll even say, you know, stuff like, you know, Lazarus and the rich man in hell, that was a parable. No, it's not. Jeremiah goes up preaching to the people in Israel, and, oh, you speak parables. No, he wasn't. Oh, Jonah, that's just a nice great fish story. No, it's not. Daniel was written afterwards. No, not according to Jesus. Here's a great one. As he that bindeth a stone in a sling. Now, if you ever took a slingshot, and you put the little rock or whatever you got, the projectile, and you put it in there, you pull that thing by it, and you let it go. Well, that whatever you use flies away. It knocks a can, window, cat, something, bird out of a tree. That's what's supposed to happen. Well, not knocking birds out of trees, but the projectile is supposed to go flying. But he that bindeth, it's interesting. Because he takes whatever he's going to project, the stone in this case, and he takes his slingshot and he glues or sews the rock to the slingshot. What's that going to do? Imagine David walking up to Goliath and he's got his little thing going. He's swinging around and somebody sold the rock to his thing. And he goes to let it go and pops himself in the head. His own head. And that's exactly what's going on here. You don't do that. Bring up the modern technology today, you take a gun. Like somebody takes a gun and at the end of the barrel they fill the hole up. So the bullet can't come out. You don't do that. It's stupid. Oh, we're not done with the verse. So is he that giveth honor to a fool. You run that back at the verse 1 in America. It's absolutely stupid. As a thorn goeth up into the hand of a drunkard. Thorn hurts. But for a drunkard, it don't hurt until after the intoxication wears off. A drunkard doesn't feel nothing. Oh, but later on when it's out of his system. How? Where did I get that from? Ooh. So is a parable. We just did it again. Verse 7. In the mouth of fools. Matthew 13:11. An unbalanced man by his leg deformity, lame, and a thorn in a drunkard after his body's been relieved of the chemicals and violation. And you trust him to teach you the Bible. One of the things that fools is, he rejects God. Psalms 14:1 and 53:1. And there are people in the pulpits, podiums, whatever you want to call it, all across the world. Teaching religiously. And are fools. There are people across the world. Of education. From a desk, podium, pulpit, whatever you want to call it. There are fools. The great God. He's a great God. Colossians 1:16. That formed all things. See, the Bible says God's the creator. It doesn't say anything about evolution. Both rewardeth the fool and reward the transgressors. All have sinned, come short of glory of God. There's no respecter of persons of God. A fool is equal to a transgressor, and a transgressor is equal to a fool. You passed a line that you weren't supposed to be there. You had no business. Fool has no business doing anything. Because it's to the wrong, the person that sent him or him. People who reject God are not high on my book. You can't trust them in anything. According to Proverbs chapter 26. As a dog returneth to his vomit, 23:35. So a fool returneth to his folly. Well, dog gets sick, throws something up that made him sick, and eventually he'll go back and re-eat it. It's embarrassing. You know, you got people over your house, something like that, your dog throws up in a corner, and before you know it, he sits there and eats it. Now, that's something you want to get on a video. YouTube across the... No. Do you know what is said about the Roman Catholic host? You know, the thing is supposed to be Jesus, if you throw it up. Do you know what's supposed to... You don't just pick it up and put it in the dustpan and put it in the garbage. And you can go online and find this out. You are to pick it up, dry it out, and then when you're able, you are to re-eat Jesus that you threw up. That's in the Catholic Church teaching. That's foolish. There it is. I mean, dead dogs. Dogs were the heathen. Dogs were unclean. Peter didn't want to be with the dogs. They were called Italians. And when he come back from the Italians, the Jews who he was meeting with then contended with him. What are you doing with those people? Jonah's like, I don't want to go over there. Bunch of vicious dogs they are. I hope my daughter, Lord, tell that dog to go away. That is, when you're reading an Old Testament Jewish book and it's likened to a dog, it ain't just a little dog you puppy hold and pet its head and give them table scraps. You are unclean, vile. That's what that is. Don't bring it home. All right. Seest thou a man wise in his own conceit?
Why don't it my way?
I've got this formula of calculation of E equals C and all this, and I got
the degrees on the wall, and
look at the frames, look at where I come from, look who I am. Look what the Bible says. There is more hope of a fool than of him. You know what the Bible just said there? If you're knocking on someone's door, if you're dealing with somebody on the street, you're at work and you got this PhD guy, and you got this guy who doesn't even believe in God, it's unfaithful to anything. The fool has more ability to get saved than the PhD. You can show a God rejecter, and you can bring him to the light. But a PhD that taught the fool that there's no God, what are you going to teach him about God when he's perfect himself? That's what the Bible says. There's more, it says there's more hope of a fool than of him. Now, it doesn't say completely helpless. But boy, it's hard. It's harder for a rich man, for a camel to go through an eye of a needle. But with God, all things are possible. A rich man can get saved. Well, the Holy Spirit's got to do some knocking on that heart. Dynamite. Got to call in the construction crew. A slothful man saith,
"Oh, but I'm not feeling well. I can't come."
Oh, that's not. Wait a minute. I'm sorry. There's a lion in the way. A lion is in the streets. There were lions there. But unless it's 4, 3, 2 o'clock in the morning when no one's up, the entire town would know if there's a lion in the road. And you gotta be careful, because we're in the day and age today. Hello, police department, what's the problem? I can't get out of my car, the dogs are there. Well, it comes down to this guy is making an excuse. He's lying. Hey, lying, get it? Lying. No, there's not a lying away, you're lying. As the door turns upon hinges. See, they had hinges back then. So does the slothful upon his bed. He sleeps so long and so much he can't sleep. He doesn't get too tired to sleep. He's got so much sleep, his body is slept up. And he wants more. The slothful hideth his hand in his bosom. It grieveth him to bring it again to his mouth. He won't even feed himself.
I'm paraplegic. I got a sore and I click Social Security because I can't work. I click welfare because I'm unable to do anything. I got a sore.
And he won't even feed himself. You know how many people in America that do not work and somebody feeds them? You know how many of our soldiers, our vets, have nobody to feed them? Are living homeless and medicalless thanks to the campaigns that this country has put them through? Isn't it great that there is a God, a creator? Isn't it great that God will judge all the earth, saved or lost? That God is the righteous judge? You think God's going to let you get away with stealing from taxpayers? And then meanwhile, you think God's going to let you get away with what you do with the people that fought for your country? I sure would not want to be in a commander-in-chief's butt when he has to give an account to God of all the soldiers that were under him. And how great our military is to its personnel. I say that tongue-in-cheek. The slugger is wiser in his own conceit than 7 men that can render a reason. You're not going to tell him anything. He's got all the excuses. You know why he won't get saved? I got that before. I already got one of them. No, later. I got my religion. Satan rules. He's asleep and receiving Christ as his savior. He's got the excuses. And you can have 7 saved men with 7 open Bibles and he's gonna talk his way through it. Excuse his way out of it with a lion.
There's contradictions in the Bible.
And where'd you name? Come on, name one. And here's the Bible, show me it. No. Put the computer down. You show me where it is. He that passes by and meddleth with strife, belonging not to him, is like one that taketh a dog by the ear. 17:11, 18:6, 20 verse 3. Do you know where my jury, your police are when they're not out looking for drunk drivers and looking for armed bandits and looking for people going in windows, all that? You know where most of your police department is? They're in homes where two people have gotten into a fight. As a man who went through the academy for the Naval Base the Police Force, one of the first things I was taught and learned and to write down in my book about domestic fights, as soon as you enter into that house, you are the enemy. I don't care how angry that wife is at her husband. I don't care how ugly that man is being to that woman. You have now stepped into their private life, and now you are the enemy. In the law where I was, in the state that I was, when a domestic fight police were called, somebody had to go to jail. You got two people battling it out. Now you're going to take one of them to jail. You're going to put cuffs on. You're going to realize how quick that fight is over. And now you and we put our police department in harm's way, where the Bible says you just rather go out and grab a vicious dog by the ear. You're going to get bit. He said, well, how are you going to solve the domestic problem and this and that? Let time heal all wounds. Well, he may kill her, she may kill him. You've told God that you don't want him in the nation. You said just do it. In your atheistic evolutionist school teaching says it's a survival of the fittest. So if that woman is stronger and better than that man, she's just going to decimate and put him down and win. That's what you've been teaching. Why are you getting all upset? And another thing this verse teaches you, if you're walking somewhere and there's a fight, don't get involved. Guy comes home to his wife, and his wife looks at him and says, why is there a marker in your head that looks like a brass knocker? Yeah, I was walking down the street, and I heard this fight, and I went knocking on the door and said, hey, I'm here to help you. Boy, and both of them slammed the door right in my head. Don't get involved. There are people who want to get involved in people's fights. You know what Paul said about, you get somebody intervenes to a fight in that. You know what Paul said about taking brethren or your wife or your husband to the court? Why not just suffer loss? By the way, I'm going to say something else about this verse. It says, he that passes by and meddle with strife, longing not to him, is like one that taketh a dog by the ears. When somebody in that house runs to their parent, that's a violation of what the Bible says. You don't go run home to your parents. You don't drag them into the fight. It's none of their business. They've got their own fights. They've got their own life. You're the one that married that person. You don't ever read about Sarah, Rebecca, Rachel, Leah. You don't ever read about any of those women going back home. You tell me all those great men in the Bible didn't have fights? Can you just picture it, Sarah? Tell me to say I'm your brother. Brother, you better step in this house and woo-wee, shut that door. You imagine the fights that Jacob had with Rachel and Leah? Two wives? Took that corkybine? You better come on in this house, brother. Imagine when Isaac realizes that Rebecca plotted the whole thing with Jacob. It was her idea. Jacob, you go off a little bit and you let mom and dad just turn the stereo up a little bit. It's a violation of scripture to get other people involved. Well, you go to an intersection, there are two people fighting road rage. That's what you've been teaching them. You're your own individual person. We're going more and more away from, you know, help others. That's what you're teaching. Be not deceived, God's not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, you're going to have to reap it. You better stick with God in the church a long time ago. As a madman who casts his fire brands, it's like an arrow that's lit on fire, arrows, that's sharp objects, and death. He's looking for harm, definitely. He's not for your best interest. So is a man that deceiveth his neighbor and said, am not I in sport? You know what that is? Verse 19. That is a practical joker. Got you. A practical joker is likened to a man that has firebrands, arrows, and death. That's like into one of those horses in the apocalypse. The Antichrist has a bull but no arrow, and it follows him death and hell. And then arrows of war. That's somebody who's always joking around with people. Well, one of these days, one of those jokes may get seriously injured, if not death. Knock it off. Deceiveth his name. That's nothing you should be involved with, deceiving. April Fool has nothing to do with a Christian. Doesn't it just tell you April F-O-O-L? Doesn't that tell you something?
Oh, we put something in the church gold, it will fool all the...
You fool. Now study chapter 26 of Proverbs, you fool. Imagine a pastor of a church playing an April Fool's joke on his congregation. And then we're supposed to trust him after all what we just read about the fool? I'm telling you. You say that would never happen. Oh yeah, it will happen. Where no wood is, the fire goes out. True. So where there is no tailbearer, the strife ceases. You got somebody telling tales in your church? Get rid of them. Church discipline. And then you'll have no more strife. What is one of the causes of strife? A tailbearer. What do? You remove him. You don't put no more wood in the fire. The fire will go out. It may take a while, but it will go out. Don't put any more wood on it. As coals are to burning coals. You know, when you got charcoal. And if you got charcoal that is gray, that gray will build into more than charcoal, because the whole charcoal is gray, and it will light other charcoals and make them gray, and then that's how charcoal works. And wood to fire. More wood in the fire, the more fire you're going to have. So is a contentious man to kindle strife. The tailbearer and the contentious man who's against everybody, get rid of. Or you're going to have fire. And fire eats up. You know what's left after burning coals are done? Ash. You know what's left when the wood is done burnt? Ash. What do you do with ash? Nothing. You put it in a pail and you throw it away. The words of a tailbearer, let's go on with him some more, are as wounds. And they go down into the innermost parts of the belly. And I've been told by a stomach doctor. Your first nervous reaction hits your intestines. That's why people get troubled with their stomachs when they get in their nervous condition. The acids in your stomach will start digesting even nothing's in there. A tailbearer causes wounds and you're to get rid of him. Or he will be a health hazard. In your family, in your church, or at work. We just picked up one of them. Burning lips and a wicked heart are like a potsherd. That's broken pottery. That's what Job took to scrape his body with. With all the boils. It's like a potsherd covered with silver dross. That's not silver. That's the junk that comes when you heat up silver. We learned that the other night. You can go back and find that. When you heat up silver and that junk floats, and you skim it off. You take that and you put it on a piece of broken pottery. Why? And that's what God is thinking of a wicked heart. You're scum covering pottery. Well, we're made from the clay. We're made from dirt. You're rolling around in mire. That's what it really comes down to. You're a pig. You're not silver. You're not valuable. Or useful. You're scum. You scum. He that hateth disassembleth with his lips. Now this you part people. You use your big mouth to cause division. And layeth up deceit within him. Deceit's not what you want to be as a Christian. When he speaketh fair, believe him not. Matthew 15:19, 6:16 of Proverbs. So he'll talk slick. It's a lie. For there are seven abominations in his heart. 16 of the Lord. Hey, yes, seven is an abomination. The soul discord among the brethren. Yeah, there's one thing, Christian, you better not stand before the judgment seat of Christ and you've done things to your brethren in your church. You've mouthed off to anybody. You get mouthy with the church people and the pastor of your church, I feel sorry standing before the judgment seat of Christ. I guarantee you lost your rewards. I guarantee it. Whose hatred is covered by deceit. Uh-oh. I mean, what he really hates, he'll... How you doing, brother? I just love you. I just care. I pray for you. And you hate him. You've been shooting your mouth off by him. But when you're standing in front of him, you'll lie. His wickedness shall be showed... That's interesting. Showed before the whole congregation. Isaiah 14, 16 through 18. And let's see. Nope, number 5. 1 Timothy 5, 20 and 1 Corinthians 4, 5. Now, that doesn't happen on the earth. Can you imagine the judgment seat of Christ when God reveals what you've been saying about everybody in your church? I'd rather go up to the person Jesus said and say, listen, you know what, brother? I have said some bad things. I have got a wicked heart, and I need to get right, and I need to... I'd rather have the Lord bring it out. You know what I mean? Whoso diggeth a pit shall fall therein. Now, that's a pit that's not... All right, I'm going to... You know, a pit is when you dig to catch a lion, I guess. This guy's lying that's in the street. You know, it's a big hole covered with branches and tree limbs so that if a deer comes running along, he falls into the hole, whatever you want to catch. It's a trap. It's a snare for a purpose. You're going to fall therein. A person does not build a pit or a trap for themselves. That's foolish. And he that rolleth a stone, it will return upon him. You reap what you sow. And you'll sow much more. Now, rolling the stone, I don't know. A lying tongue hateth those that are affected by it. Wow. I just told a little white lie. The Bible says you hate them people that you lied to. I don't really hate them. The Bible said you hate them. Are you going to have a problem with the Holy Spirit? If you really loved them, you would have told the truth. That's what the scripture's saying. And a flattering mouth worketh ruin. What a mouthful. We've gone from fools to the slugger to crackle jokers to people who cause troubles. That's a great chapter full of people. And they're in your church. And many churches that I've been in, they get the praise and honor. Verse 1 and verse 8. They get the positions. Verse 1 and verse 8.